Savior. If you dare to say that out of your mouth, you are anointed. And God wants to increase your anointing, and he wants it to overflow. Listen, I probably shouldn't even say this, because you think I'm judging, but maybe I shouldn't say it. But when I saw a certain athlete, you know, Magic Johnson was my boy. It wasn't Michael and them youngsters. It was Magic. Magic, man. Showtime. And, man, I was a little, boy, I get excited about watching Magic Johnson. Now, some of y'all didn't know. But one day, I saw his son in the story. I ain't gonna say no more. Rest of you need to go look it up and say, well, Pastor, talking about Magic, so watch Magic. For you not to have the anointing on your life is like looking at Jesus and then looking at one of the three stooges. It should be an embarrassment for you not to know, to understand, the anointing. We are more proud to have the anointing of our father, our parents on us. You know how we feel when our father, if he told you, or somebody told you, man, look at you, you walk just like your father, you know, you walk, or something, and they tell you got anointing. If your father come to you, say, man, when I was in high school, I was running too, and you better than me, you running. When you know you got the anointing, your mama tell you something. You know, girl, you just like me. You can do this like me. You do it better. Whatever. When you realize that a human being who you love, you have their anointing on your life. How many know it feel good? Yeah. Amen. When a father tells a son, boy, you chip off the old block. When auntie them say, boy, you just like your brother, like my brother. That is how we come to understand anointing. When someone relates to us, how we are like a relative. It may be a relative we don't even know. You act just like Uncle Joe. And then we want to know, well, who's Uncle Joe? What's he like? Because what they're saying is that that spirit that's on him is on you, if it's good, hopefully. For us, you, listen, to be here as a Christian, and you not know how to tap into the anointing is the greatest robbery in the whole earth. Bigger than if you would go into Fort Knox, bigger than if you would go into a bank. The greatest robbery sitting in this room is that you don't know how to go in to the richest place in this earth or hemisphere, and that's where the anointing is. The greatest tragedy, there's a scripture in John 10:32. You don't have to go there. The shortest scripture in the whole Bible, but it's a very impactful scripture. Two words. It says, Jesus wept. And he wept simply because people did not know or understand the anointing that was upon his life. The greatest tragedy is not for you not to go to college, for you to go to prison because you've done something wrong, for you to commit murder, for you to have babies and can't take care of them, for you to get beat up at the mall, for you get run over by a car and recover, whatever. You can just think of anything. The greatest tragedy in this world is for you to be born again and not know how to open the door and go in where your spiritual treasures are. That's the greatest, man. You may live this life and never have get married. You may never go to college. You may have the biggest house, but you are poor. You will never understand what it is to be rich. You can go to church all you want to. And I got more church days clocked in than probably most of y'all in here. You know, and some of y'all, when your father was a pastor and his father was a pastor and your grandpa on both sides was pastors and they stayed in church. And so clocking church hours on the road, don't do it. We should do that. But the greatest resource for you is the anointing. Until you come to understand the anointing, you can never be satisfied by alcohol, drugs, women, weed, sex, money, property, Nothing will satisfy you. I don't care how much money you got, and you can have a whole kilo of coke and snort it. You will never, never understand the anointing. You can smoke some of the best reefer, man, that the earth got. Some that come from the Congo. Some that come from Acapulco Gold. Somebody done stirred up in their kitchen right here. You know, mix some Drano in it. Mix some Lysol. Whatever you need to get there. You won't understand the anointing, man. No, I'm saying it because, you know, once you get on that track, bam, if it ain't good enough, you're mad at the person that you bought it from, you're looking for him, you know. Man, this some whack stuff, I don't want it. And, you know, you want something higher. That's how people OD or people lose their mind because they were actually looking for the anointing. Because there is no high greater than an anointed high. You see the suit now, man. You know, see the tie. You see the smooth. But you don't see when I was a sinner and I tried all that stuff. I ain't ashamed of it. Tried it. That's what you do coming from where I came from. You know, you get high. But you know what? I found out that all I was really looking for was the anointing because once I found the anointing. I said, this is it. This is that man when I was traveling the road looking, buying them dime bags, nickel bags. I mean, you know, I was spending too much money. Well, let me pull it back a little bit. I was looking for the anointing. I found them church people with some jive time turkeys. I'm being honest, but I'm going to show you something to close it out here. I told church people some jab time turkeys, man. And some of y'all think the same thing. Them jab turkeys. They don't know. They still say jab turkeys. Okay. They don't say that no more. I will forgive me. They said jab turkeys when I was coming. They don't know. Well, let's start it up again. Ooh, the joy of the Lord is my strength. But I did, man. I didn't think they knew nothing about happiness because they was crying. They always grunting and stuff. And we sit in the back of the church, couldn't wait to get out of the church, man, where somebody... Let me hip you to something your parents told you not to do. Anything mama them say don't do, it was like, okay. It didn't matter. Here, come here, let me show you something your mama and daddy say don't do. That was a call for the, well, y'all didn't do it. I did it. But I did not know. I'm trying to help somebody. Give you a shortcut, man. That it was all in anointing. So it wasn't in church unless church was going to help me to get to the place I could tap in anointing. So church ain't a bad thing. I believe in the church. I believe in churches. And not because I'm a pastor. I believe in churches because the church is the body of Christ. It's God's institution he left in the earth to get us to glory. If done right, it's supposed to be a place where we learn and we're transformed into the image of Christ. Church people are not perfect people because you in it and because your mama in it. I'm playing the dozens now. Your daddy in it. All your family in it. You know how they act. So it ain't a perfect place. So when you go to church looking for perfect people, you came in wrong. It's like going to Walmart looking for a steak and ale. You know, you're in the wrong place. Yeah. But if you, David said this, listen, David said, like a deer that is, he uses the word panteth, after the running brook, or a deer is searching for fresh water, so my soul search for you. If you ever can come to the place where you can realize that the same effort, I'm talking about me, the same effort I put into going to those kinds of things, if I had turned that to come to God, I would have discovered a fountain to fill everything I had, because all of that stuff wasn't cool after a while. It was a burden. Now, who am I talking to? It was a burden trying to go around decent folks smelling like a field on fire. Like burnt rope all the time. Got to apologize. And if you got a mama, she always, what's wrong with your lips? What's wrong with your lips? You know, my auntie there, what's wrong with your lips? You know, now you got to lie about your lips. Been smoking them black ones. It was. People who thought better of me would see me. These were church people, like these people up here, loving the Lord, you know, and I felt they did no wrong. So I can't judge them. I didn't see any fault in them. But they would catch me. Here I'm trying to get a buzz on to handle my day. Oh, I'm talking about inspiration right now. I'm trying to get that buzz on so I can go around these jive turkeys. You got to keep a buzz on when you're hanging with jive turkeys. They bore you to death. Your mama, your auntie them, that bald head preacher, well, you know, fat preacher. All them church folks. All they want to talk about, Jesus, 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 you know. You be looking at them, ankles all swole. You be looking at them. Kids see a lot of stuff. Back then, we look at the moles on your neck. We're like, man, what's on them moles? Things growing on Sister Jones's neck, you know. We wouldn't eat your cake because we saw a bunch of moles on your neck. Moles all on your face. Like, man, she look weird, man. I ain't eating that cake. We throw it at each other. Throw the cake at each other. After church, she didn't see it. I ain't eating that. You see how... It's the truth. Church kids is mean, man. And they see everything. And the way folk praise the Lord, they already made up in their mind, I ain't never going to praise the Lord like Deacon so-and-so. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord. They be like, I don't care. I'm too cool for that. You know, ain't the truth. I'm trying to hit on the girl over there in the choir. And you think, I'm going to get into all that old mess. Oh, I'm trying to see her after church. Ain't that right, George? You anointed, son. But try to walk around like you cool. See? That's what most of y'all doing. Y'all trying to be C-O-O-L, C-O-O-L. Been there, done it. Some of you youngsters and some of the old folks. You still trying to maintain this kind of suave kind of thing. And, you know how it is. You got your way, you get in your swing shade, you know. That's your problem. God is saying, I got something for you. I got something, the bomb for you. The Holy Ghost is hollering at you, you know. I got the hook up. But you're scared. Some of y'all ain't man or woman enough to go behind the veil. Oh, I'm talking to you now. Y'all, you got hair on your chest, man, and you know what I'm saying? But you ain't man or woman enough to go behind the veil. You ain't scared of nothing, but I got something that, oh, y'all don't want to hear me. I got something that wants you to get some of this. Okay, you made me do it. Let's go to Acts chapter 8. Give me, add 3 minutes to my time. I had 3 minutes of my time. Y'all made me do it. God, you think God invented dancing? Listen, Y'all think God got in this thing late. God invented sex. S-E-X. Guess who invented sex? God. God invented sex. God invented sex. Luther didn't do it. Teddy Pendergrass didn't do it. God. Who else about sex? Dr. Ruth didn't do it. God invented sex. How you think you got here? How do you think you got here? Have you ever thought about two people decided to have you? And we ain't got no twins in the room, do we? You had a day when you was the only one. Everybody was looking at you. I ain't seen too many pretty babies. I mean, I'm going to be honest with you. Most babies in me are ugly. I'm just going to be honest with you. Some of y'all need to quit lying, too. Oh, he's so cute. That baby ain't cute. That baby ugly. But don't get offended. This, I'm going to stay with the gospel. A lot of y'all wasn't cute. You cute now, you look good now. But a lot of y'all, when y'all was born, you was only cute to your mama and your auntie them. The rest of the world seen you and they was like, and they talked about you. That's one ugly baby. It's the truth. But look at you now. I ain't trying to hurt your feelings. I'm just trying to say. But somebody had you. You were conceived. Because God wanted you in the earth to make a difference. That's all I'm trying to say. And the reason your skin is the color it is, because God chose that color for you. You didn't choose it. You'd have chose something color they didn't make. You to run God's FedEx people back and forth. I don't want that color. Give me another color. That ain't the right color. That ain't the right shade. Just wore them people out. God chose the color of your skin. He chose the grade of your hair. He chose it all. God chose it. He chose your eyes. Oh, help me, Holy Ghost. I'm hearing all along here. He chose your eyes that when you the only one with the new technology, when you look into the thing and the vault open, your eyes. Ain't nobody got it. So it's true when somebody says, ooh, you got the most incredible eyes. You sure right. Sure you're right. I got them. Because ain't nobody got no eyes like me. Drugs and alcohol change your eyes. They do. Because all that come out in your eyes. But your eyes, not distorted, are beautiful. Black eyes are beautiful. You ain't just got to have hazel. Y'all buying these contacts and all this. You ain't got to have hazel and blue. Oh, that's good. But your eyes are beautiful, and they are different. Your skin. You might have trouble with your skin right now. That's all right. God made it. It's going to all come out. You're going to lose all that. Don't talk to young people if you can hear me. You're going to lose all that. You're going to grow all that. You're going to lose that baby fat. Some of y'all 60 and still trying to lose it, but just keep working. You're going to lose it. It's coming off you. It's coming off you. It's coming off you. Y'all think I'm playing. You can't go to rapture with all that. God got to trim that off. He's going to trim it to the bone to get you out of here. Okay, let's move on in. I'm trying to encourage somebody, but it probably is. So when they call you black, celebrate it. They call you high yellow, celebrate it. Because you didn't choose it no how. God chose it. Okay, let's hurry up. Let's go to Acts chapter 8. Ain't nothing but a little baby fat. That's all it is. Acts chapter 8. Eight and five. Praise God. You know why I'm talking like this today, on this today, is God. The Holy Ghost is being poured out upon all flesh. All means everybody in here, everybody watching, everybody that's walking, everybody in the bad places, everybody. All means all. Listen, preacher, I'm going to pour out my spirit on all flesh, not just church people. People go to church on all flesh. Because why? All souls belong to me. We shall all give an account before God. So if all means all us God's children, when I'm buying McDonald's, I'm going to buy McDonald's for all my children. If I'm taking them to a fun place, all my kids. Come on, all of them. One missing, where are he in the back? Bring them. We all going to do this. We're going to all sit down together. I'm not going to just feed two of my kids and don't feed the other two. I'm going to feed the ones that I had to discipline. Yep. Put them in time out. And I'm going to feed the ones that I pat them on the head or on the shoulder and told them, you're doing an excellent job. But all. Mama cooked for all. It didn't matter when she said, dinner ready. Everybody came. If you had gotten whooped or put in the room bad, all. So God is a better parent than he says it in Luke chapter 11. If you ask your father for bread, will he give you a stone? If you ask him for bread, would he give you a stone? Then he says, how much more shall the Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask? Asking it shall be given, seeking it shall find, knocking shall be opened, the door shall be opened unto you. In other words, God, it is his delight to give you the kingdom. And the kingdom is his spirit, man. God is so wonderful that he created the whole world. I feel his presence right now. He created the whole world. You don't really pay attention sometimes, but I was driving the other day, and, you know, I just looking at the trees and the grass, and even in Oklahoma, which is not the most scenic place, you know, not the most scenic place, but I thank God for the glory. I just noticed the trees and the snow and all. And man can't create one teaspoon of dirt, nor can he make a tree, nor can he make one bird or bird feather. He can't make grass. And all this is God's glory. You know, when I used to get high, I would trip on that stuff. Come on, where my weed smokers at? Okay. This is what you call real church. Because I'm a real preacher. And this is real life. And we are living in a time where that is part of the pleasure of stimulants, is to take mundane things and to make them mean something. That's why we do it. See? So now, devil, we exposed you. So here's what I want to say. But those things were never to replace the Holy Spirit. Just like I said, God created sex. God created dancing. We think that the world, we call the world people that don't go to church. God created dancing. Dancing, God created dancing. God created dancing. Dancing was for him. God created clapping. God created singing. Singing wasn't for the devil. I know it's like he took it over, and that's real big now. And church folk, they sing. We know they sing, but there's some people out there, and you got all these CDs or whatever you got, people singing and whatever. No, but God created singing. And everything that he created was for his glory. He created dance for his glory. He's a jealous God. You got to know something about God here. And I'm going to get my pedal to the metal right here. Yeah. You got to know something about God. God is jealous. He is jealous. His name is jealous. When he see us spend most of our life, because he only give us a certain amount of time on earth. The Bible says like 70 years, yet by strength you might live 80. Okay, you make it to 90. You ain't gonna make it past 100. God still is jealous. And when he created you, he got mom and daddy, one and two, to get together to have you. And then he blew the breath of life. And then he sees that, okay, I gave something you can have, which is life. And you're gonna spend all your life having sex the wrong way. It ain't that God is like saying, I hate sex. He created sex. Yeah. You spend all your life dancing the wrong way. Yeah. Now, come on. Yeah, yeah. You danced even if you were square. They still say square. I mean, if you was a square. You danced. Yeah, 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 yeah. You danced if you didn't have rhythm. So all your life, God created something for mankind to do, and man does it most of his life in nightclubs, in dives, in the dark, lights down low, low music, bumping and grinding. I don't see nothing wrong. All that. And God is like saying, you know, I'm like jealous. It ain't that God is just like this stick in the mud, y'all. Yeah. But God is like, I'm jealous. I gave you life. God created sex. He created dancing. God created singing. And all the songs you ever sang is all these songs that are just corrupt and whatever. He's jealous because you, young people, didn't create you. Old folks, too. You didn't create you. Your college didn't do it. You didn't create you. You can't. The Bible says this, although I question this. You can't add one hair to your head. They didn't have stores. Says you can't add one hair to your head. And yet we act like our hair belongs to us. I created this fashion. And God is simply saying, you everything you do and you've done in your life, you've done it for self, for your glory, for others. You've dressed for others. You danced for others. You had sex with people you really didn't like, but you did it. You know what I'm saying? After a time, you looked at them, you couldn't stand them. Didn't know they were snaggletooth. They didn't have no teeth. You know what I'm saying? The eyes went both ways. You didn't know all of this. You didn't see this. You know, you danced. You did. Hello? Boy, he's really looking at me. But it's true.